This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book The Alhambra by Washington Irving. The Journey. In the spring of 1829, the author of this work, whom curiosity had brought into Spain, made a rambling expedition from Seville to Granada, in company with a friend, a member of the Russian embassy at Madrid. Accident had thrown us together from distant regions of the globe, and a similarity of taste led us to wander together among the romantic mountains of Andalusia. Should these pages meet his eye, wherever thrown by the duties of his station, whether mingling in the pageantry of courts, or meditating on the truer glories of nature, may they recall the scenes of our adventurous companionship, and with them the recollection of one, in whom neither time nor distance will obliterate the remembrance of his gentleness and worth. And here, before setting forth, let me indulge in a few previous remarks on Spanish scenery and Spanish traveling. Many are apt to picture Spain to their imaginations as a soft southern region, decked out with the luxuriant charms of voluptuous Italy. On the contrary, though there are exceptions in some of the maritime provinces, yet for the greater part, it is a stern, melancholy country, with rugged mountains and long sweeping plains, destitute of trees, and indescribably silent and lonesome, partaking of the savage and solitary character of Africa. What adds to this silence and loneliness is the absence of singing birds, a natural consequence of the want of groves and hedges. The vulture and the eagle are seen wheeling about the mountain cliffs and soaring over the plains, and groups of shy bustards stalk about the heaths, but the myriads of smaller birds, which animate the whole face of other countries, are met within but few provinces in Spain, and in those chiefly among the orchards and gardens which surround the habitations of man. In the interior provinces, the traveler occasionally traverses great tracts cultivated with grain as far as the eye can reach, waving at times with verdure, at other times naked and sunburnt, but he looks round in vain for the hand that has tilled the soil. At length he perceives some village on a steep hill or rugged crag, with moldering battlements and ruined watchtower, a stronghold in old times against civil war, or Moorish inroad, for the custom among the peasantry of congregating together for mutual protection is still kept up in most parts of Spain in consequence of the maraudings of roving freebooters. But though a great part of Spain is deficient in the garniture of groves and forests, and the softer charms of ornamental cultivation, yet its scenery is noble in its severity and in unison with the attributes of its people. And I think that I better understand the proud, hardy, frugal, and abstemious Spaniard, his manly defiance of hardships and contempt of effeminate indulgences, since I have seen the country he inhabits. There is something, too, in the sternly simple features of the Spanish landscape that impresses on the soul a feeling of sublimity. The immense plains of the Castiles and of La Mancha, extending as far as the eye can reach, derive an interest from their very nakedness and immensity, and possess in some degree the solemn grandeur of the ocean. In ranging over these boundless wastes, the eye catches sight here and there of a straggling herd of cattle attended by a lonely herdsman, motionless as a statue, with his long slender pike tapering up like a lance into the air, or beholds a long train of mules slowly moving along the waste like a train of camels in the desert, or a single horseman, armed with blunderbuss and stiletto and prowling over the plain. Thus the country, the habits, the very looks of the people, have something of the Arabian character. The general insecurity of the country is evinced in the universal use of weapons. The herdsman in the field, the shepherd in the plain, has his musket and his knife. The wealthy villager rarely ventures to the market town without his trabuco, and, perhaps, a servant on foot with a blunderbuss on his shoulder, and the most petty journey is undertaken with the preparation of a warlike enterprise. The dangers of the road produce also a mode of traveling resembling, on a diminutive scale, the caravans of the East. The arrieros, or carriers, congregate in convoys and set off in large and well-armed trains on appointed days, while additional travelers swell their number and contribute to their strength. In this primitive way, is the commerce of the country carried on. The muleteer is the general medium of traffic and the legitimate traverser of the land, crossing the peninsula from the Pyrenees and the Asturias to the Alpuxarras, the Serranía de Ronda, and even to the gates of Gibraltar. He lives frugally and hardily. His alforjas of coarse cloth hold his scanty stock of provisions. A leathern bottle, hanging at his saddle bow, contains wine or water for a supply across barren mountains and thirsty plains. A mule cloth spread upon the ground is his bed at night, and his pack saddle his pillow. His low but clean-limbed and sinewy form betokens strength. His complexion is dark and sunburnt, his eye resolute but quiet in its expression, except when kindled by sudden emotion. His demeanor is frank, manly, and courteous, and he never passes you without a grave salutation. Dios guarde a usted, vie usted con Dios, caballero, God guard you, God be with you, cavalier. As these men have often their whole fortune at stake upon the burden of their mules, they have their weapons at hand, slung to their saddles, and ready to be snatched out for desperate defense, but their united numbers render them secure against petty bands of marauders, and the solitary bandolero, armed to the teeth and mounted on his Andalusian steed, hovers about them like a pirate about a merchant convoy without daring to assault. The Spanish muleteer has an inexhaustible stock of songs and ballads with which to beguile his incessant wayfaring. The airs are rude and simple, consisting of but few inflections. These he chants forth with a loud voice and long drawling cadence, seated sideways on his mule, who seems to listen with infinite gravity and to keep time with his paces to the tune. The couplets thus chanted are often old traditional romances about the Moors, or some legend of a saint, or some love ditty, or, what is still more frequent, some ballad about a bold contrabandista, or hardy bandolero, for the smuggler and the robber are poetical heroes among the common people of Spain. Often, the song of the muleteer is composed at the instant and relates to some local scene or some incident of the journey. This talent of singing and improvising is frequent in Spain and is said to have been inherited from the Moors. There is something wildly pleasing in listening to these ditties among the rude and lonely scenes they illustrate, accompanied as they are by the occasional jingle of the mule bell. It has a most picturesque effect also to meet a train of muleteers in some mountain pass. First you hear the bells of the leading mules, breaking with their simple melody the stillness of the airy height, or perhaps the voice of the muleteer admonishing some tardy or wandering animal, or chanting at the full stretch of his lungs some traditionary ballad. At length you see the mules slowly winding along the crag defile, sometimes descending precipitous cliffs, so as to present themselves in full relief against the sky, sometimes toiling up the deep arid chasms below you. As they approach, you descry their gay decorations of worsted stuffs, tassels, and saddlecloths, while as they pass by, the ever-ready trabuco slung behind the packs and saddles gives a hint of the insecurity of the road. The ancient kingdom of Granada, into which we were about to penetrate, is one of the most mountainous regions of Spain. Vast sierras, or chains of mountains, destitute of shrub or tree and mottled with variegated marbles and granites, elevate their sunburnt summits against a deep blue sky, yet in their rugged bosoms lie engulfed verdant and fertile valleys, where the desert and the garden strive for mastery, and the very rock is, as it were, compelled to yield the fig, the orange, and the citron, and to blossom with the myrtle and the rose. In the wild passes of these mountains, the sight of walled towns and villages, built like eagles' nests among the cliffs and surrounded by Moorish battlements, or of ruined watchtowers perched on lofty peaks, carries the mind back to the chivalric days of Christian and Muslim warfare and to the romantic struggle for the conquest of Granada. In traversing these lofty sierras, the traveler is often obliged to alight and led his horse up and down the steep and jagged ascents and descents, resembling the broken steps of a staircase. Sometimes the road winds along dizzy precipices, without parapet to guard him from the gulfs below, and then will plunge down steep and dark and dangerous declivities. Sometimes it struggles through rugged barrancos, or ravines, worn by winter torrents, the obscure path of the contrabandista, while ever and anon, the ominous cross, the monument of robbery and murder, erected on a mound of stones at some lonely part of the road, admonishes the traveler that he is among the haunts of banditti, perhaps at that very moment under the eye of some lurking bandolero. Sometimes, in winding through the narrow valleys, he is startled by a hoarse bellowing, and beholds above him on some green fold of the mountain a herd of fierce Andalusian bulls destined for the combat of the arena. I have felt, if I may so express it, an agreeable horror in thus contemplating, near at hand, these terrific animals, clothed with tremendous strength, and ranging their native pastures in untamed wildness, strangers almost to the face of man. They know no one but the solitary herdsman who attends upon them, and even he at times dares not venture to approach them. The low bellowing of these bulls, and their menacing aspect as they look down from their rocky height, give additional wildness to the savage scenery. I have been betrayed unconsciously into a longer disquisition than I intended on the general features of Spanish traveling, but there is a romance about all the recollections of the peninsula dear to the imagination. As our proposed route to Granada lay through mountainous regions, where the roads are little better than mule paths and said to be frequently beset by robbers, we took due traveling precautions. Forwarding the most valuable part of our luggage a day or two in advance by the arrieros, we retained merely clothing and necessaries for the journey and money for the expenses of the road, with a little surplus of hard dollars by way of robber purse to satisfy the gentlemen of the road should we be assailed. Unlucky is the too wary traveler who, having grudged this precaution, falls into their clutches empty-handed. They are apt to give him a sound rib-roasting for cheating them out of their dues. Caballeros like them cannot afford to scour the roads and risk the gallows for nothing. A couple of stout steeds were provided for our own mounting, and a third for our scanty luggage and the conveyance of a sturdy Biscayan lad, about 20 years of age, who was to be our guide, our groom, our valet, and at all times our guard. For the latter office he was provided with a formidable trabuco or carbine, with which he promised to defend us against riteros or solitary footpads. But as to powerful bands, like that of the Sons of Asija, he confessed they were quite beyond his prowess. He made much vainglorious boast about his weapon at the outset of the journey, though, to the discredit of his generalship, it was suffered to hang unloaded behind his saddle. According to our stipulations, the man from whom we hired the horses was to be at the expense of their feed and stabling on the journey, as well as of the maintenance of our Biscayan squire, who of course was provided with funds for the purpose. We took care, however, to give the latter a private hint that though we made a close bargain with his master, it was all in his favor, as if he proved a good man and true, both he and the horses should live at our cost, and the money provided for their maintenance remain in his pocket. This unexpected largesse, with the occasional present of a cigar, won his heart completely. He was, in truth, a faithful, cheery, kind-hearted creature, as full of saws and proverbs as that miracle of squires, the renowned Sancho himself, whose name, by the by, we bestowed upon him, and like a true Spaniard, though treated by us with companionable familiarity, he never for a moment, in his utmost hilarity, overstepped the bounds of respectful decorum. Such were our minor preparations for the journey, but above all, we laid in an ample stock of good humor and a genuine disposition to be pleased, determining to travel in true contrabandista style, taking things as we found them, rough or smooth, and mingling with all classes and conditions in a kind of vagabond companionship. It is the true way to travel in Spain. With such disposition and determination, what a country is it for a traveler, where the most miserable inn is as full of adventure as an enchanted castle, and every meal is in itself an achievement. Let others repine at the lack of turnpike roads and sumptuous hotels, and all the elaborate comforts of a country cultivated and civilized into tameness and commonplace. But give me the rude mountain scramble, the roving haphazard wayfaring, the half-wild yet frank and hospitable manners which impart such a true game flavor to dear old romantic Spain. Thus equipped and attended, We cantered out of fair Seville city at 6:30 in the morning of a bright May day, in company with a lady and gentleman of our acquaintance, who rode a few miles with us, in the Spanish mode of taking leave. Our route lay through old Alcala de Guadera, Alcala on the River Ira, the benefactress of Seville that supplies it with bread and water. Here live the bakers who furnish Seville with that delicious bread for which it is renowned. Here are fabricated those roscas well known by the well-merited appellation of pan de Dios, bread of God, with which, by the way, we ordered our man Sancho to stock his alforjas for the journey. Well has this beneficent little city been denominated the Oven of Seville. Well has it been called Alcala de los Panaderos, Alcala of the Bakers, for a great part of its inhabitants are of that handicraft, and the highway hence to Seville is constantly traversed by lines of mules and donkeys laden with great panniers of loaves and roscas. I have said Alcala supplies Seville with water. Here are great tanks or reservoirs, of Roman and Moorish construction, whence water is conveyed to Seville by noble aqueducts. The springs of Alcala are almost as much vaunted as its ovens, and to the lightness, sweetness, and purity of its water is attributed in some measure the delicacy of its bread. Here we halted for a time, at the ruins of the old Moorish castle, a favorite resort for picnic parties from Seville, where we had passed many a pleasant hour. The walls are of great extent, pierced with loopholes, enclosing a huge square tower or keep, with the remains of masmoras or subterranean granaries. The Guadera winds its stream round the hill at the foot of these ruins, whimpering among reeds, rushes, and pond lilies, and overhung with rhododendron, eglantine, yellow myrtle, and a profusion of wild flowers and aromatic shrubs, while along its banks are groves of oranges, citrons, and pomegranates, among which we heard the early note of the nightingale. A picturesque bridge was thrown across the little river, at one end of which was the ancient Moorish mill of the castle, defended by a tower of yellow stone. A fisherman's net hung against the wall to dry, and hard by in the river was his boat. A group of peasant women in bright-colored dresses crossing the arched bridge were reflected in the placid stream. Altogether, it was an admirable scene for a landscape painter. The old Moorish mills, so often found on secluded streams, are characteristic objects in Spanish landscape and suggestive of the perilous times of old. They are of stone, and often in the form of towers with loopholes and battlements, capable of defense in those warlike days when the country on both sides of the border was subject to sudden inroad and hasty ravage, and when men had to labor with their weapons at hand, and some place of temporary refuge. Our next halting place was at Gandil, where were the remains of another Moorish castle, with its ruined tower, a nestling place for storks, and commanding a view over a vast campiña or fertile plain, with the mountains of Ronda in the distance. These castles were strongholds to protect the plains from the talas or forays to which they were subject, when the fields of corn would be laid waste, the flocks and herds swept from the vast pastures, and together with captive peasantry hurried off in long cavalgadas across the borders. At Gandil we found a tolerable posada. The good folks could not tell us what time of day it was. The clock only struck once in the day, 2 hours after noon. Until that time it was guesswork. We guessed it was full time to eat, so alighting, we ordered a repast. While that was in preparation, we visited the palace, once the residence of the Marquis of Gandil. All was gone to decay. There were but two or three rooms habitable and very poorly furnished. Yet here were the remains of grandeur, a terrace where fair dames and gentle cavaliers may once have walked, a fish pond and ruined garden, with grapevines and date-bearing palm trees. Here we were joined by a fat curate, who gathered a bouquet of roses, and presented it, very gallantly, to the lady who accompanied us. Below the palace was the mill, with orange trees and aloes in front, and a pretty stream of pure water. We took a seat in the shade, and the millers, all leaving their work, sat down and smoked with us, for the Andalusians are always ready for a gossip. They were waiting for the regular visit of the barber, who came once a week to put all their chins in order. He arrived shortly afterwards, a lad of 17 mounted on a donkey, eager to display his new alforjas or saddlebags just bought at a fair, price $1 to be paid on St. John's Day in June, by which time he trusted to have mown beards enough to put him in funds. By the time the laconic clock of the castle had struck two, we had finished our dinner. So, taking leave of our Seville friends, and leaving the miller still under the hands of the barber, we set off on our ride across the Campiña. It was one of those vast plains, common in Spain, where for miles and miles there is neither house nor tree. Unlucky the traveler who has to traverse it, exposed as we were to heavy and repeated showers of rain. There is no escape nor shelter. Our only protection was our Spanish cloaks, which nearly covered man and horse, but grew heavier every mile. By the time we had lived through one shower, we would see another slowly but inevitably approaching. Fortunately, in the interval there would be an outbreak of bright, warm Andalusian sunshine, which would make our cloaks send up wreaths of steam, but which partially dried them before the next drenching. Shortly after sunset, we arrived at Arahal, a little town among the hills. We found it in a bustle with a party of Micalays, who were patrolling the country to ferret out robbers. The appearance of foreigners like ourselves was an unusual circumstance in an interior country town, and little Spanish towns of the kind are easily put in a state of gossip and wonderment by such an occurrence. Mine host, with two or three old wiseacre comrades in brown cloaks, studied our passports in a corner of the posada, while an alguazil took notes by the dim light of a lamp. The passports were in foreign languages and perplexed them, but our squire Sancho assisted them in their studies, and magnified our importance with the grandiloquence of a Spaniard. In the meantime, the magnificent distribution of a few cigars had won the hearts of all around us. In a little while, the whole community seemed put in agitation to make us welcome. The corregidor himself waited upon us, and a great rush-bottomed armchair was ostentatiously bolstered into our room by our landlady for the accommodation of that important personage. The commander of the patrol took supper with us, a lively, talking, laughing Andalus who had made a campaign in South America, and recounted his exploits in love and war with much pomp of phrase, vehemence of gesticulation, and mysterious rolling of the eye. He told us that he had a list of all the robbers in the country and meant to ferret out every mother's son of them. He offered us at the same time some of his soldiers as an escort. "One is enough to protect you, senors. The robbers know me and know my men. The sight of one is enough to spread terror through a whole sierra." We thanked him for his offer, but assured him in his own strain that with the protection of our redoubtable squire, Sancho, we were not afraid of all the ladrones of Andalusia. While we were supping with our draw-cancer friend, we heard the notes of a guitar and the click of castanets, and presently a chorus of voices singing a popular air. In fact, mine host had gathered together the amateur singers and musicians and the rustic bells of the neighborhood, and on going forth, the courtyard or patio of the inn presented a scene of true Spanish festivity. We took our seats with mine host and hostess and the commander of the patrol, under an archway opening into the court. The guitar passed from hand to hand, but a jovial shoemaker was the Orpheus of the place. He was a pleasant-looking fellow with huge black whiskers, his sleeves were rolled up to his elbows. He touched the guitar with masterly skill, and sang a little amorous ditty, with an expressive leer at the women, with whom he was evidently a favorite. He afterwards danced a fandango with a buxom Andalusian damsel, to the great delight of the spectators. But none of the females present could compare with mine host's pretty daughter, Pepita, who had slipped away and made her toilette for the occasion, and had covered her head with roses, and who distinguished herself in a bolero with a handsome young dragoon. We ordered our host to let wine and refreshment circulate freely among the company, yet, though there was a motley assembly of soldiers, muleteers, and villagers, no one exceeded the bounds of sober enjoyment. The scene was a study for a painter. The picturesque group of dancers, the troopers in their half-military dresses, the peasantry wrapped in their brown cloaks, nor must I omit to mention the old meager alguazil in a short black cloak, who took no notice of anything going on, but sat in a corner diligently writing by the dim light of a huge copper lamp that might have figured in the days of Don Quixote. The following morning was bright and balmy, as a May morning ought to be, according to the poets. Leaving Arahal at 7 o'clock, with all the posada at the door to cheer us off, we pursued our way through a fertile country, covered with grain and beautifully verdant, but which in summer, when the harvest is over and the fields parched and brown, must be monotonous and lonely, for as in our ride of yesterday, there were neither houses nor people to be seen. The latter all congregate in villages and strongholds among the hills, as if these fertile plains were still subject to the ravages of the Moor. At noon we came to where there was a group of trees, beside a brook in a rich meadow. Here we alighted to make our midday meal. It was really a luxurious spot, among wild flowers and aromatic herbs, with birds singing around us. Knowing the scanty larders of Spanish inns, and the houseless tracts we might have to traverse, we had taken care to have the alforjas of our squire well stocked with cold provisions, and his bota or leathern bottle, which might hold a gallon, filled to the neck with choice Valdepeñas wine. As we depended more upon these for our well-being than even his trabuco, we exhorted him to be more attentive in keeping them well charged, and I must do him the justice to say that his namesake, the trencher-loving Sancho Panza, was never a more provident purveyor. Though the alforjas and the bota were frequently and vigorously assailed throughout the journey, they had a wonderful power of repletion, our vigilant squire sacking everything that remained, from our repasts at the inns, to supply these junketings by the roadside, which were his delight. On the present occasion he spread quite a sumptuous variety of remnants on the greensward before us, graced with an excellent ham, brought from Seville. Then, taking his seat at a little distance, he solaced himself with what remained in the alforjas. A visit or two to the bota made him as merry and chirruping as a grasshopper, filled with dew. On my comparing his contents of the alforjas to Sancho's skimming of the fleshpots at the wedding of Camacho, I found he was well versed in the history of Don Quixote, but, like many of the common people of Spain, firmly believed it to be a true history. "All that happened a long time ago, señor," said he, with an inquiring look. "A very long time," I replied. "I dare say more than 1,000 years," still looking dubiously. "I dare say not less." The squire was satisfied. Nothing pleased the simple-hearted varlet more than my comparing him to the renowned Sancho for devotion to the trencher, and he called himself by no other name throughout the journey. Our repast being finished, we spread our cloaks on the greensward under the tree, and took a luxurious siesta in the Spanish fashion. The clouding up of the weather, however, warned us to depart, and a harsh wind sprang up from the southeast. Towards 5 o'clock we arrived at Osuna, a town of 15,000 inhabitants, situated on the side of a hill, with a church and a ruined castle. The posada was outside of the walls. It had a cheerless look. The evening being cold, the inhabitants were crowded round a brasero in a chimney corner, and the hostess was a dry old woman who looked like a mummy. Everyone eyed us askance as we entered, as Spaniards are apt to regard strangers, a cheery, respectful salutation on our part, caballeroing them and touching our sombreros, set Spanish pride at ease, and when we took our seat among them, lit our cigars, and passed the cigar box round among them, our victory was complete. I have never known a Spaniard, whatever his rank or condition, who would suffer himself to be outdone in courtesy, and to the common Spaniard, the present of a cigar, puro, is irresistible. Care, however, must be taken never to offer him a present with an air of superiority and condescension. He is too much of a caballero to receive favors at the cost of his dignity. Leaving Osuna at an early hour the next morning, we entered the Sierra or range of mountains. The road wound through picturesque scenery, but lonely, and across here and there by the roadside, the sign of a murder showed that we were now coming among the robber haunts. This wild and intricate country, with its silent plains and valleys intersected by mountains, has ever been famous for banditti. It was here that Omar ibn Hasan, a robber chief among the Muslims, held ruthless sway in the 9th century, disputing dominion even with the caliphs of Cordova. This too was a part of the region so often ravaged during the reign of Ferdinand and Isabella, by Ali Ater, the old Moorish alcaide.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.